Okay. I think we can start. Thank you for attending this session. I have a lot of pressure because after talking after Dr. Delvin is quite a challenge, to be honest with you. The message that he sent was quite powerful. I will go through the presentation is about the journey we engage at Société Générale. Société Générale, for those who don't know, is a bank, French bank with a global footprint, more than 150,000 employees. The headquarters is in France, and it has now a strong footprint also in Europe, East Europe, America, and Africa. So that's the context of this presentation. What do we mean by business value creation is what was the journey that we engaged a couple of years ago to transform the bank into a two data-driven organization. That was the main objective. And through this presentation, you will see the different steps that we've been through. The journey is far from being achieved. There are still a lot to be done. And I will try as much as I can to go through these different steps, different achievements, and so that you can, I hope, learn from it and maybe apply what went well and forget about where we failed. So my name is Pierre-Étienne Bardin. I'm leading the big data and data science organization at a corporate function. So the bank is split in three main areas. There is an investment bank, a retail bank, and corporate functions. And I'm leading the big data and data science team at the corporate function. I won't talk about in details the investment banking, nor I won't talk about the retail banking, but I will go through this journey and we'll get a flavor of how it is applied also to the other part of the bank. But I'm responsible for big data and data science at the corporate functions. This is not the logo, it's a visual identity of what we started to build. It's a way to communicate about us internally, about our organization. So the Big Data Hub is a dedicated organization that has been created in 2014 to be able to build the foundation where on which each and every project can be supported or can leverage what could be a global platform, global foundations to accelerate the journey. So this is about a team, a team of experts. When we talk about experts, it's many type of expertise, typical data expertise plus more global expertise. The team is central. Even if it belongs to different part of organization, we built a virtual team so that we can leverage the expertise from each and every entity where they exist. So somehow we create a community of experts. And its main purpose, it's really to set up the ground for each and every local initiatives on big data to have the acceleration, the foundation part that could be very complex at the project level to implement. So that's global investment is being managed by this team. It supports retail, corporate function, and also bank at everywhere within the world. So that's very global footprint in terms of building the foundations. Now what we did and how did we start the journey? We failed, but we failed fast. That's always when you start something new, when you start to innovate, it's never a first day success. So when I say that, I guess some of you in your audience, if he's telling us that he failed, why are we here? In fact, failure, there are many ways to fail in data, in big data, in data science project. Either you have the wrong use case, either you have the wrong team, the wrong technology, you don't have data. I mean, I've seen a lot of projects about data science and big data, and I ask us, okay, where are your data? Oh, we don't have them yet, but maybe we can collect them. So there are many reasons to fail. But in data, the particularity of failure is if you fail fast, you capture a lot of knowledge. You have a lot of lessons learned on this failure. First, you know your data. You have identified your gaps. You have identified some knowledge on your data. You have identified the use case that doesn't work versus the use case that could work. So that's really key for us to gather every outcome of a failure so that we can accelerate the next use case that we will work on. And I have a lot of examples where we started a use case, so we gathered the data, we set up the team, we work on that use case, and in fact it was not providing any value. But it was at the end of the journey that we noticed that the use case was not working. We did in fact 80% of the job, which was collecting data, analyzing data, understanding data, gather the team to have a business knowledge on this data, being connected to the business processes. That was already key, and in fact it was very easy to move on a second use case on the same data set and with the same team. So the failure is we have to be very careful with it. It's if we fail fast, it's a true asset and it's a true way of working. And in fact, you have to put that in the mind of all the manager and the senior people that failing is not a bad thing. It's really something that on which you can leverage. Now, in terms of project, what you need also to move on, it's some flagship. You need some very concrete projects that deliver value end to end and that are very visible by the senior management. So we had a couple of flagships that we use, and in fact was one of the key flagships that we had. It was a very big challenge regarding regulatory project, where we have to manage more data than usual. It was a factor of 1,000, and in fact, with the technology that we have, we were working on hundreds of thousands of records, and the regulator asked us to move to millions and millions of or many millions or tens of millions, and with the technology that we had, we could not match with this requirement. So we propose. And in fact, the initial reflex from the group was to say, okay, let's see how we can leverage the existing technology, because the regulatory pressure is so high that we don't want to innovate in many areas. So that was the first reflex. And what we propose in parallel, it's to work with big data compared to in parallel of the traditional system and the traditional way of working. And working with big data, so we had 3 months to demonstrate that with big data we can manage millions and millions of contracts at the detail level. We can execute hundreds of controls on this contract, and we can provide a full audit trail because this was the requirement of the regulator. And by successfully doing that, so we had the help of Hortonworks, and we asked Hortonworks to help on that project where they brought one of their best Scala Spark developer. We managed in less than 3 hours to execute, because that was the challenge. We had to execute all these controls on millions of contracts in less than 3 hours with the existing technology that we have. So we had an Hadoop cluster and we used Scala Spark for that. We were able to go through we reached this level of performance, and we create a certain level of confidence within the management. So that's key because with this, you demonstrate that you can achieve very critical projects. At least it's not the end of the journey. By 3 months, I don't mean that we address the IFRS.9.2 aspect, but we manage to put within the ecosystem this big data technology as part of the standard assets and standard technology that we can use even for very critical projects for the bank. So that's key for us. Uh, I was talking about the flagship. So we had one flagship, and we managed to demonstrate big data. But as I introduced myself, I have also the responsibility for data science. So you need to find also, on that aspect, you need to find additional flagship on each technology that we want to use. So data science was part of our key ambition. So we had to find also another type of project that would demonstrate our capability to significantly improve, enhance one of the key business processes of the group. And by doing that, we had this momentum was launched, and people start, the senior management and the business started to believe in us, and they were more open to work with us on additional type of aspect of the group. So that was, with this first success on regulatory, we managed to go within the group to transform step by step all area of the group. In terms of use cases, and it's quite standard if you are part of the banking system, what type of use cases we achieve. So we managed to do real-time fraud detection by using data science and artificial intelligence. We managed also to do anti-money laundering, so we significantly improve our capability to detect this type of behavior. We work on risk, risk management. We work on ALM, asset liability management. We started to implement NLP, so natural language processes techniques, for all the documents that we have to read, that we have to understand, that we have to analyze, that we have to cross-check. So these NLP techniques, applying text mining, was quite helpful in some areas. In others, it was a fast fail. NLP is not applicable for every topic. We work, of course, on customer knowledge, customer 360. So we built a customer 360 type of model, so that we can gather through the data lake all information that could help the different business processes to accelerate. And we work also, I'm talking about business, but of course we apply big data and machine learning techniques to IT, to security, log management. So we have all this aspect also that are being covered by the techniques that we set up. So that could be considered as a small step for as has been said when someone landed on the moon. It was a big step for the company. So that's really a major achievement for us, being able to cover all the aspects of the business areas in a very limited amount of time. Because I'm talking about two years window. I don't mean that we end up everything. We have a lot of things to do, but we manage to convince every area of the business that they should be able to leverage these technologies, either big data or machine learning. How did we do that? So as I said, flagship is key, because then you can demonstrate the capabilities that we have. But flagship is not enough. I mean, flagship will convince the people that are aware of it. You have to communicate a lot. So we put in place a dedicated way to communicate and to interact with the business. And we have three phases to communicate with the business and to make sure that they understand and they are becoming more aware of what we can achieve. So having this flagship is key, but you need to communicate. And these three phases is: first, we inspire. Second, we experiment. Third, we industrialize. So that's the three steps that we use to convince and to embark the business with us. So inspiration is you have to showcase. Either you showcase internally, if you have already your flagship available, that is very powerful, or you ask other business or other companies to showcase for you. That's something that you have to do, because you have to make the people who are not aware of that, what value could they can extract from this big data techniques and data science. So you have to showcase, and it's a demonstration. We organize full day session where we had a forum, we have workshops when they can interact with the team, with the expert. They can discuss with the data scientists, they can discuss with the data engineers, they can understand what has been done on other areas within the bank or outside of the bank, and then they start having some ideas. They do the parallels with what their current issues, their current problems, and they start identifying these ideas. And with these ideas, we can easily move to the next step, which is experiment. Once they have an idea, we can launch a dedicated workshop to experiment. Experiment means we analyze the idea, we define the criteria, whether it is a big data and data science idea. Sometimes they have ideas and that has nothing to do with us. So we have to reject this experiment, but most of the time they understood what big data and data science could bring, so they came with their ideas. So we experiment, and with experimentation we start to identify and to put in place some big data and data science within their business processes. And the next phase is industrialize. And industrialization is, how do I put that into an operational mode? How do I really create value? How do I move to the intention, to the actionable insight? That's really key. For this industrialization, we have five key area of offer. We have the data lake. For those who want to store data, process data, so the first flagship that I've shown, the project on IFRS 9.2, was about building a data lake for all the contracts of the group, transforming this contract, controlling this contract, putting an audit trail on this transformation. So that's a data lake. That's one part of the offer. Usually, this is a key step to start building a single area where all the data are being captured. The second step is, or the second type of offer, is data quality. I don't know if you have this issue, but we have this issue internally. We have poor in terms of quality sometimes. So adding on top of the data lake some processing to enhance quality or to identify the lack of qualities and be able to have some clear information to demonstrate that we miss there are some areas where we don't have the right level of quality is also key for us. So data quality is a second area where we can support the different businesses. The third area is enhanced analytics. Enhanced analytics is it's a terminology that we use for BI. So enhanced analytics, you put in place some dashboarding, advanced dashboarding, agile dashboarding connected on your data lake. So that brings the business new type of data. Data that are connected together that were never been connected together, and some powerful tools that gives the power to the business to discover the data that they never touched before. So that's also a strategy for us to feed the data lake. All these five areas that I'm describing are strategy to feed the data lake, because our goal and our what is at stake, it's being able to gather all the data in one single place. The next, the fourth one is advanced analytics, so putting in place machine learning, data science into the loop, so that we can extract even more value than on the data that we get. And the last one is building custom application on top of the data lake, so that the business or whoever is the user can interact directly with the content of the data lake, but not directly having a U connection on the data lake, but having a custom application that hide the complexity below, using AngularJS and D3JS, so that they can access to the data, but with a more user-friendly interface than we have usually on Hadoop. So that's how we interact with the business. Now the team, very quickly, the team that we have and the expert that we have, three types of expertise that we didn't have before: data scientists, data engineers, and specialists in data visualization. Data scientist is the guys who are managing the model and managing the statistical and mathematical model. Data engineer are the guys who are building the pipeline and putting that together so that we have a software at the end which is industrialized. And the data visualization are the guys who are hiding the complexity by putting some storytelling around this, so that business can easily understand what is below and what is behind this data and this algorithm. You have on top of that architects, of course. Security is key. It's key to have security within your team. It's also key to have compliance guys, where you have some potential issue with compliance. I know that US has a less and less issue with privacy, but we still have in Europe, hopefully. So this kind of skills also is key. People on the Hadoop side, on the infrastructure, are also some new skills that are really key in order to make sure that you can build on top and have the right and a proper evolution of your ecosystem, so that it match with the requirements that are coming up from the open source community. So that's the team that we set up. The way we are organized is we try to be full agile with feature team. Product owner belongs to the business most of the time, and the rest of the feature team belongs to the IT side mostly. But at the end, we don't care about where this guy belongs. The goal is to have one co-located team, ideally. If they can be in one place, that's cool. And all together, with all these skills together, so that we can easily work in agile mode, having 2 week streams, two week sprints, so that we can easily fail fast and move very quickly to another type of use case. So that's the team. In terms of technologies, I won't go into the details of technology that we use. We are using mostly 99% of open source. Hortonworks, of course, as a basic. But on top of Hortonworks, we are using Spark Scala, as I said. On data science, it's mostly open source model and open source libraries on machine learning and deep learning. Kafka on a streaming Spark. I mean, all the ecosystem that you know and that you are familiar with, we are trying to leverage that as much as we can. The challenge is we have in a completely different time frame. When we rely on open source, the open source community is so active that it generates new ideas and new type of technologies and new versions on a very frequent basis, where traditionally, we had some system that can stay 5 years without being updated. So there is a different pace that we need to put in place, and it generates some potential issue within the traditional way of working. But we want to leverage as much as we can what the community is putting and making us available. So that's why we have this type of mindset. The key words for us is adaptation. We have to adapt, and we have to make sure that all the ecosystem that we are putting in place is capable to become as adaptive as the world is changing around us. Now we have, I said that we failed and that we still have some major challenges in front of us. The challenges are mostly the culture. We need to have a culture shift, because putting in place big data and data science, it's less a matter of technologies and on skill than on a culture change. As I said, the different pace that this is bringing to the organization is a very is shaking the organization, and in a way it usually works. So the culture aspect is really key for you to anticipate, and you have to make sure that people understand how they will be impacted by this. And it's not only let's put in place some IT guys, they will create their Hadoop cluster, and we have done with big data. It's much more complex than that, and the transformation, it's like data transformation, it's really like digital transformation. It impacts everyone, and at the end of the day, if you don't anticipate or if you don't make the business understand that they will be heavily impacted by all these new techniques, because it will change their business process, it will change the way they work. Experts today are fully relying on their expertise. Tomorrow they will be not replaced, but they will be augmented by some tools and techniques that will help us to define and to make their decision. That's if it is not anticipated, that is really complex to deliver within the pace of the project. If you consider that at the end of your project, you will be able to convince and manage and do the change management afterwards, it won't work. You need to anticipate that upfront, or you will fail in the delivery of your project. So that's really key. The workplace has not to be underestimated. The workplace is, and when I talk about workplace, is the laptop, it's the desk, the office, it's the way you interact with your environment, the development environment, with the way you interact with the team. The workplace is really key, because one of the biggest challenges that we have is recruitment, is attracting talents. We are not on top of the list of the talents when they think about joining a company. Usually they have in mind either GAFA or startups. So to be able to be at that level and to be compared with GAFA, you have to make sure that you built an ecosystem which is similar to what they can find in Google. And it's not that easy. If you think about putting in place, setting up Mac instead of Windows, it's a nightmare in certain companies, because security has only approved Windows type of workstation, where the developers and the data scientists only work with Linux or with macOS. So you have to adapt, and this change is also key to quite difficult to achieve, because you have to fight against a whole organization. Again, in terms of attractiveness, we have also to convince people to join us, and the traditional way of recruiting is not working. I mean, you still have to maintain this traditional way of connecting with people, but it's not enough. You have to go where the experts are. You have to go in the meetup. You have to organize. You have to contribute to their community so that they can understand and they can identify you as someone who is working on the same type of topics that they are. So that's you have to go where they are, and you should not wait them to come to you. They will never come by default. Unless you are Google or Facebook, it's quite difficult for us to be attractive enough. The second aspect is upskilling. We have 150,000 employees, so identify the potential talents that could be upskilled to data science, to data engineer, to specialist in visualization, system administrator on Hadoop. That's also a challenge for us, because we don't have the tools and techniques and the capabilities to identify within 150,000 employees, within a CV, what are the characteristics and what are the skills that are required for this new role. This new role are not described, so we don't have a set of competency, a set of skills, so it's difficult for us to match with existing CV existing CV within a group and say, okay, to what extent these guys can be trained to that. So that's also a challenge. And the last one is retention. As soon as they join or they have been skilled and they are becoming experts, how do we make sure that we can retain them within a group? After 3 years of expertise, they become heavily bankable on the market. They are being chased, they are being hunted by headhunter. So that's quite a challenge, to make sure that you create the right ecosystem so that people feel in the right place in your organization. That's quite tricky, because the more they become experts, the more they are being chased by outside. So you have to, and the way we manage that is by putting in place and making sure that we have the right challenges, the right amount of data, the right use cases that differentiate us from the rest of the businesses. So that's putting in place challenges, having a continuous way of connecting the expert between them, and feeding them with use cases is, for me, the best way to make them happy at work. But that's quite a never-ending challenges. The next step now So I've seen, we've seen the moon. The next step is Mars, of course. Huh? We are ambitious. So let's jump directly there. The next step for us is to continue industrialization. Industrialization of all this stuff. We have done that in 2 years. We have done that in a hurry mode. It was not quick and dirty, but it was fast enough to miss some industrialization aspects. So this is where we have to focus in the coming months and in the coming years. Continuous integration, continuous delivery. It's one of the aspects that we want to work on. Being able to move from what I call lab to fab, so laboratory to fabric. We, with all the experiments that we did, we have a lot of POC. POC is good, but it doesn't bring any value. That's a POC, so it's a potential of value, but there is no value within a POC. So moving a POC to an industrialized phase is quite a challenge when you talk about data science, and when you do that very quickly in 6 weeks, packaging it so that it can be run in a fully trusted mode without any issue during night and without any bugs and package in a way so that it can gather data, execute the model, and push the right information to the right guy so that it can make decision is quite a challenge. So the industrialization phase is quite tricky. Putting in place some servicing, so we didn't put in place enough APIs on our system. So we have also to put that in place. The batch has been the most of our activities was around batch. So we have now to put in place more streaming, more real time into our processes. But you cannot start with real time at the first phase, because you need to, even if you think big, you need to start small. If you start to build a cathedral, and if it is your ambition, then you will potentially fail. So that's why we foster batch at the beginning, where the business case was it was necessary to put in place streaming in real time. We did it, but now we have to think more broadly about putting in place streaming type of model. Coupling with the information system. We were a little bit disconnected to the information system, so now we have to create really some pipelines to feed the data lake and push the actionable insights to the rest of the information system. So that's also a parallel of the streaming phase. We have to put in place privacy by design. I mean, regulation is becoming tougher and tougher, so that's something that we have also to take into account. This is really key. Enhancing the whole level of security to anticipate the new regulation, and GDPR is a key challenge for us. So that we have plenty of challenges, but in a nutshell, that's what we have today. And of course, we have retention. That's always a case. That always here on the table. And putting in place also, that's also something that we have to push. I talk a lot about the organization, the central organization. But at the end of the day, we will be successful if big data and data science is democratized enough. As it can be used by anyone within the organization. I'm not saying that 150,000 employees will be able to use Hadoop. That's not my point. But we have within a group some key people to whom we can transfer the know-how and transfer the skills so that they can use on their own and build their own project by connecting to the ecosystem. So the model that we have, the big data hub that I've described at the beginning, is something that is a center of expertise, but it should not be the end of the story. This center of expertise has one of his key missions. It's to transfer the know-how so that the level of autonomy is very high within all business area and all the IT organization, so that they can work on their own on our platform. So that's really the model that we have that we put in place by training the guys, putting in place internal university, defining a career path for the guys, so that we can upskill all the organization. And they can be fully autonomous on that technologies. Last words on the Hortonworks collaboration. One of the key aspect of our success was due to a strong collaboration with Hortonworks, and really when we had this flagship and we could not miss the timeline, and we had to be very successful within 3 months. We ask the support of Hortonworks and they work we work together with one of their tech lead to really work on that that Scala Spark techniques and Scala Spark data processing. And we are in connection and in contact with Hortonworks on a regular basis so that they can help us on data management with the new tools that we set up, which is also a key challenge for us. So we have a regular interaction with Hortonworks, and we leverage their skill set in order to make sure that we are following the right path. So they are a sounding partner. That's how we see them. We are also careful with the new techniques that they come with, which is usually not dry enough to be implemented. So that there is also some cautious to be taken with all the technology that they brought on the table. But we have a continuous interaction so that they can understand our issues and they can help us to define what will be the next steps of the journey. So this is what we also put in place with our Stonework quite recently. So I don't have any clear feedback on how it will succeed, but they help us also to present, to define the business cases regarding use cases that we work on. Either you have identified a potential use cases and help you with all their knowledge and all their background to define what could be the potential business use cases on this use case that help you to define and to present it and to defend this case to the board, or they help you with an existing and a delivered use cases that help you to assess the business case on that and the value that you created. And sometimes, because you don't have all the keys, you miss some value that they can, with their knowledge and with their broader scope of you, they can help you to identify what kind of savings, what kind of cost avoidance, what kinds of lead time you have generated in terms of outcome. I'm done with my presentation. We have five minutes for questions. If you had any questions, I would be happy to answer to those. Yes. So the main culture change is, so fail fast was not part of the culture, and when I say fail fast is when you miss something, you have to be proud of it, and that was not part of the culture. When you fail, and it was you have to be miserable. So that's something that you have to change. Also, the test and learn approach. Testing and learning. Usually, within the bank, they easily understand what test and learn means for them, but they consider that for us, the guys who are building that, we are not testing and we are not learning. So they consider it's just them that are in learning phase. We are fully accountable and we are fully knowledgeable on the system. We have to make them understand that everybody is testing and learning, and we have to adapt ourselves. So that's also something which is quite tricky to put in place. Then agility depends on your level of maturity. Agility, if you have a V type of V cycle type of project, then moving to agility it's a big challenge. If your organization is already in agile mode, then it's quite easy, because agile mode is well fitted to test and learn and to be able to adapt whenever something wrong happens. So that's also something that you need to put in place. And regarding also change, we have also to put into their hand some tools. Some new ways of working which they are not familiar with. I mean, when we talk about experts were working on their set of data, limited set of data, and most of the decisions were coming from their knowledge. Tomorrow, you're asking them to take into account some data that are being built by a model that they don't understand, or they have some difficulties to understand how it works. And they have to make their decision based on that. Not only on that, but they have to take into account based on that solution that they are not familiar with. So that's also something that needs to be managed, because some of them have the feeling that they are losing power. In fact, they are not feeling augmented, they are feeling disempowered. I still have one question. Time's up. No. One question? Is it okay? Yeah, one question. Just one. Sorry. No, we are using mostly to start with Tableau because it was quite easy to manage with a big amount of data, and also it's quite helpful for data discovery. Now we are testing Superset, so the Airbnb stuff that has been released three weeks ago, but we didn't end up with a one standard solution. In fact, BI tools, there are many tools within a group. Our goal is to be able to connect them with big data. Sometimes it works, sometimes they are not capable to absorb this amount of data. So we propose our own solution, or we do a custom application with D3GS. I need to stop now. Sorry. I can take a question offline if you want.